So we have two more lectures left. So for this week, we'll be focusing now on storage. And what we're going to now look at is how to handle databases that exceed the amount of DRAM that we're going to have available to our system. So for today's class, we'll focus on how can we do this in the context with hardware that we have today, like spinning disk hard drives and SSDs. And then on Thursday's lecture, we'll talk about sort of the new non-volatile memory devices that are pretty close to actually coming out. And I'll talk more about like what they all are and what company's gonna be the first one to put out something on the market. So real quick before we get started on the lecture material, just to go through the upcoming schedule for the rest of the semester. Next Thursday, in this location in class, we'll have the final exam. So it'll be at the regular class time. And so this will be it'll only be an hour long. It'll be a combination of multiple choice and short answer questions that covers everything we've talked about in the lectures in the class. And then I'll provide on Thursday's class, I'll provide a sample final exam to give you an idea what these questions sort of look like. The way to sort of think about these, what this exam will be about, it's not going to be questions that ask you about very specific things on the different topics or papers that we discussed, right? I'm not going to ask you in multiverse concurrent control, if a transaction does this, what happens, right? It's more about trying to synthesize the high-level ideas of the different concepts and techniques and methods that we've talked about the entire semester, and to be able to extrapolate them further and apply them to different scenarios. So if you understand at a high level what's actually going on, rather than what specific algorithms are doing, that should be enough, because that's sort of the important thing here. Because you can always go back, look at the papers or look in the textbook to see what actually the algorithm does. Yes, question?
May the 3rd is a Wednesday. Right?
All right, then it should be May the 4th then. Thank you, yes. All right. That's an easy fix. Yes, if you May the 4th. So. I'll do it now, because otherwise I'll forget. The code review, I think I'll check the website. It might be also be May 3rd, May 4th. We'll double check this. But any questions about the exam? It'll be next class in Thursday, the 4th, not the 3rd. For the code review for the second round, it's either May 3rd or May 4th. It doesn't necessarily matter. But again, the idea here is that you're going to make your code for your project available to the other group, even though, again, you haven't finished. It's just sort of as a process of getting feedback and as you work towards the final project. And then for what we have scheduled for our final exam, according to the university, is set for May 9th. I don't know what day of the week that is. I guess if it's the 3rd, the 4th, then it's I think it's a Tuesday then. This will be at 5:30 p.m. in Wien Hall in some other room that I've never been before. And this is where you do the final presentations for your project. So every group will have 12 minutes. I'll order pizza because it'll be at dinner time. And the idea here is sort of a lighthearted thing where everyone sort of goes through and talks about what they actually accomplished. And then the code drop, when we actually try to merge all your stuff in, will occur after this point here. All right, so any questions about this? Okay, the other news I want to bring up is actually one correction for something I said in last class. I said that the bit weaving stuff that Wisconsin developed made it inside the Apache QuickStep system. That is actually not true. They took all that out when they made QuickStep open source in an Apache project. So if you get QuickStep now, if you download it from the website, it doesn't have any of the bit weaving stuff. It's still only in the Wisconsin-only system. And the other cool announcement I have is that they announced the 2017 SIGMOD Awards. So SIGMOD is the big conference in databases, the big academic conference. It's going to be next month in Chicago. And they announced that Gertz Graffy won the COD Innovations Award. So this is sort of an award they give out to honor someone who's made contributions in a sort of major field of databases over a long period of time that it's had a big impact. And so we've read a lot of Gertz's stuff in this class, right? We talked about cascades, we talked about the volcano model, we talked about index locking and latching, right? So he's done a lot of stuff in databases that has a lot of big impact. So this is a good thing that he finally won this award. So that's just an aside that happened in the last week. All right, so for today's agenda, we're going to talk again about how a in-memory database management system can now support databases that exceed memory. And the basic idea or way to think about this is that we want to be able to now, you know, DRAM can only get so big, and we want to have databases that are bigger than DRAM, but we want to be able to use all the stuff we've talked about the entire semester of how to have this main in-memory oriented architecture for our database system, and still now be able to access things on disk without bringing all the slow stuff we got rid of at the beginning of the semester. Right? Remember I showed that pie chart at the beginning that said in a transaction system for OLTP workloads, you know, 30% of the time was spent in the buffer pool, 30% of the time was in recovery and the lock manager, and only 12% of the time that the system was actually spent doing useful work. Now we want to bring back disk, and we don't want to go back to that original pie chart. So that's sort of what we're trying to accomplish here. So I'll start off talking about some background material about why this is sort of a tricky problem, and then I'll talk about the things you have to be mindful of when you actually implement support for on-disk data in an in-memory database system. And then I'll walk through some specific examples of how people have implemented this in a real database system architecture. And the paper you guys read was an anti-caching work that we did. And that's sort of one of these examples that we'll go through. And then we'll finish off with an evaluation that we did last year about looking at all these different implementation issues and running them against different types of storage devices you can have and seeing which ones were better than others. All right, so it's sort of, again, obvious why we want to do this. DRAM is expensive compared to like an SSD or a spinning disk hard drive. Again, it's not only is it more expensive to actually buy, it's actually also more expensive to run. So what I mean by that is they've done studies where they've measured what the power consumption is on a rack server to measure where the power actually goes. And they find about 40% of the energy goes toward refreshing DRAM, right? Because the way DRAM works is that it's since it's volatile, every so often they have to sort of send a charge into the cells to have it maintain whatever the value that it's being stored. So 40% of the time in the CPU, or it's not the CPU, 40% of the energy is being spent on just refreshing this. So it'd be really nice if we can get, again, all the benefits of having a fast, optimized in-memory database system without having to pay more for, pay up this high energy cost. And so ideally, we want to be able to shove things out to disk and only bring that back into DRAM when we actually need them. So, that's the big idea that we're trying to do here. And the major thing that we have to be mindful of when we start adding back disk is that the way we're going to access storage on a disk-based system is different than an in-memory system. Remember in the beginning of the semester, I talked about how these sort of classic disk-oriented database architectures are inherently block-oriented or page-oriented. And that's because that's the interface that the hardware provides for you, right? You can write 4 kilobyte pages. You can't write to individual tuples when you write out to an SSD or a disk. So now we need to be able to sort of seamlessly deal with block-oriented storage, even though the architecture that we've developed for our indexes, for our execution engine, for our compression schemes and everything, are inherently tuple-oriented, are dealing things at the byte level. So that's sort of the challenge that we deal with in this world. So what I'll first say, though, for this discussion, we're really going to only focus on OLTP. And this is because in the case of OLAP, there's not really that much you can do that's special. Because in OLAP, you're essentially just going to be accessing the entire table or doing long sequential scans of large segments of the table. So there's not really any magic we can build in our database system to make this go faster. Yes, we can do prefetching, we can do some pre-computed aggregations and things like that, and this is what sort of standard database systems do now. But there's not anything, because we're in-memory architecture, that we can make the OLAP queries run faster when we have to read things from disk. The disk is always going to be the bottleneck. And so let's say we have to do like a sequential scan on this column, right? Typically what you'll see something is like to use zone maps where you maintain in memory some pre-computer aggregations and other information about, say, the attribute that you're trying to scan on for an individual column. And you keep this in memory so that when your query comes along and says, all right, do I need to access anything in this, maybe this block of data that's on disk, I can look in my zone map first and do some early filtering and make some decisions about whether there's anything even on disk I wouldn't even look at. So this is probably, the only sort of optimization you can do. And this is used in a lot of different systems. So this is what MemSQL does. But this is also what Vertica does, even though Vertica is a disk-oriented system. So there's nothing specific about this that makes it, you know, that you can only do this in an in-memory system. This is a standard optimization technique that you can do. But again, if we need something out here, we have to go fetch the whole thing in and just scan it. All right, so this is sort of clear. We're only going to focus on OLTP because in that case, we want to be clever about what data gets moved out, and then when we bring data back in, what do we actually keep around in memory? And how do we actually treat the transactions? Or what should happen to the transaction that tries to access data out on disk? So in the case of OLTP, we have this distinction of our database that we've talked about before, and a lot of the different techniques we've talked about are based on this, is that there's always going to be this notion of hot data versus like the cold data. And the hot data is the data that's being, you know, recently accessed or recently modified by transactions, and therefore it's being more likely to be accessed in the future. And then over time, as it ages, or for whatever high-level semantics of your application changes, some data becomes cold, and therefore it's not going to be accessed in transactions anymore. And so the idea here, what we want to be able to do is that we want to recognize that we're going to have hot data, we want to keep that in memory, and we want to have cold data and move that out the disk. And so if we ever need it, we can still go fetch it, but we'll pay a performance penalty to go do that. But for the common case where most of our transactions are accessing hot memory or hot data, then we're going to just work like before. We'll run really fast. And this is sort of what the anti-caching term comes from in the paper you guys read. Because what I'm describing here is essentially what a disk-oriented system does. Now, if you have a buffer pool, they put the hot pages in memory and leave the cold data out on disk. And that's, you know, they call that caching. In anti-caching, it's been flipped around where everything starts out on disk, or sorry, everything starts out in memory as hot, and we push the cold stuff out the disk over time. So that's sort of where the anti-caching term comes from. It's a reversal of what traditional caching does. So what we're going to need in our database system, we're going to need some kind of mechanism or component that will be able to take our stuff out of memory and put it out in disk, maintain some information about what's actually being stored there, and then if any transaction or query tries to access that, we know how to go fetch it and bring it back into memory. So the sort of high level, it looks sort of like this. So for this also, I'll say for this lecture as well, we're going to ignore the problem of moving memory from the index out to disk. Remember I talked about, when we talked about compression, I said for some databases, the indexes can be 50% of the actual total size of the database in memory. But for everything we'll talk about here, and I'll say why this is a problem later on, we're going to leave the index alone. We're going to assume the index is always going to be in memory, and we're only going to focus on moving tuples out to disk. So let's say that somehow we identify that these three tuples here are what's cold. And I'll say too, as I go along through this example, I'm going to put little question marks and say what are the problems we have to solve, or what are the design choices we have to make in our database system at these different steps to be able to do this moving cold data out. So the first issue is that we decide that these three tuples are cold, so we're going to move them out into memory and put them out on disk into a block. And again, this is an SSD or a spinning disk hard drive, so it's inherently going to be a block-oriented device. So we're going to pack a bunch of these guys together. There'll be a little header at the top that says what's actually being stored here, but then it'll be written out to disk. And so this will be like an evicted tuple block, right? Because we're evicting the data out of memory and putting it out on disk. So now the question we've got to deal with is, what are we actually going to put here, right? We don't want to lose, you know, if we just shove this data out the disk, then nothing else in the system will know about it, and we won't be able to find it. So we may have to maintain some extra metadata in memory to say, there used to be a tuple here, but it's not, and if you actually need it, here's where to go find it. All right, and then now in our index, what should the index actually point to? Should it point to like the original location or where these tuples used to exist? Or will we have some auxiliary data structure that says, here's where to go find the tuples that you're looking for? So now I say you have a query comes along, and say this is some query that wants to do a lookup on this table, but it wants to go retrieve tuple 01, right? And the tuple 01 is out on disk. So now, assuming we have some kind of mechanism that knows how to find 01 from just the in-memory metadata, and it knows it's out here in this page at this offset, now we got to make a decision of how we're going to move it back in, right? Should we just take the entire page and move all the tuples back into memory? Or should we only pull out the one tuple that we need and put that in memory, leave this on disk, and maintain a little marker that says, you know, there's a hole here because the tuple that used to be here is now actually in memory. And then the other question we have to deal with is what should happen to this query, right? Assume this is running in a transaction. It does this query on tuple 01. We recognize that it's not in memory and we have to go fetch it. Should we abort it, put it in a queue, and then a background thread go fetches the data that we need? Or should we stall the thread right here and then synchronously go fetch the data that it needs? Right? In a disk-oriented system, they will stall the thread, right? Because they'll make the request to the buffer pool manager. The buffer pool manager will recognize the thing's not there, and then this thing gets stalled while it goes fetch the thing that it needs to bring to memory. But in some systems, like in HDR or VoltDB, because they have these single-threaded execution engines, that may actually be a bad idea to stall the thread, because now you're stalling all these other transactions. So this is all sort of tightly related to what concurrential model or execution scheme you're using in your database system. So for this class, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through all these different question marks and say, what are the different design choices that you can have? And I'm not going to claim one's better than another, but we'll see at the end when we do our evaluation, we'll see how these things to perform on different types of storage devices. All right, so now you may be thinking to go back, again to the second lecture when we talked about in-memory database architectures. Couldn't we just do this with MMAP? Because MMAP kind of solves all these problems that I'm showing here, right? And I've said early on that you should never use MMAP for your database system. I still stand by that. If I die, put that on my tombstone, right? That's something I believe in very strongly. And so the reason why you don't want to use MMAP for this, although we'll see one example where they do use MMAP, but in a clever way and not sort of the way you would think you would normally use MMAP, what I'm talking about here. The reason is because if we let the OS start managing stuff for us, we're going to lose the fine-grained control, right? And we have to deal with this problem here that any time that we have a page that gets modified by a transaction, the steal no force policy says that we have to make sure that we write out the log record that corresponds to the update to that page to disk first before we're allowed to write that page out. But if we let the OS make decisions about what gets flushed out the disk, then it may flush out the dirty page before it flushes out the log record. Now you can use mAdvise and mLock to make sure that doesn't happen, but then you have other problems, like you can't have a separate thread asynchronously read ahead in your on your pages on disk and start prefetching things, and you also cannot do multiple flushes to pages atomically using MMAP, right? So you can do msync to say flush this individual page, make sure that goes out the disk, but you can't have it run flush multiple pages concurrently at the same time. And so there have been some papers that sort of extend MMAP to sort of solve this problem, but as I understand now, in the POSIX implementation of MMAP, you can't do this. So again, we'll see one example where they don't have to worry about these two problems, and they can use MMAP. But in general, we don't want to use MMAP to solve this problem entirely. All right. So for OLTP, this is sort of the hierarchy of the different issues we have to deal with in our large-than-memory support in our database system that I sort of showed in the diagram going before. So I'll go through each of these three categories one by one. So the first will be runtime operations, like what should happen inside the database system to identify which tuples are cold. And then once you identify those tuples, then you have policies that specify how should you evict the data. right? When should you do this? What sort of metadata you need to maintain in memory to keep track of what you've shoved out? And then when you have a transaction try to access something that's been evicted, we have a bunch of questions we have to deal with, like how much data should we be bringing back in? Whether we should stall a thread or do it in the background. So again, we'll go through each of these. All right, so the first problem we have to deal with is the cold tuple identification. And again, the high-level idea here is that we need a mechanism inside of our database system that can say these individual tuples are not likely to be needed by transactions or queries in the future, and if I'm running out of space, it's okay for me to shove them out. So you can do this on an online or offline manner. So in an online manner, you basically have the data system itself is somehow keeping track of the access patterns of queries on tuples, and then when it comes time to decide what you know that you need to move things out, you just consult this metadata to find the things that you want to move out. So in the case of the anti-caching paper, they maintain this sort of an LRU chain that's directly embedded inside the tuple headers, so you don't have a cache miss or cache line miss when you go access the tuple and need to update this pointer. The idea here is every single time that a tuple is accessed, then you move it to the front of the chain. So when you want to decide, I need to move data out, you just look at the back of the chain, and you know those are the coldest tuples because they have not been accessed recently, so you can shove them out. An offline manner is used in Hecaton and in Apache Geode, which we'll see in a second. And this is basically where you have a separate thread monitors the an access log that's generated by the engine that says, here's all the individual tuples that are being accessed. And then when it comes time to say, all right, I need to move data out, what tuples are cold, you consult this log and you figure out what things have not been touched, and that's how you identify things. I think the first approach is better because it's guaranteed to be sort of in sync with the actual application, what the application is actually trying to do. But you could have the case where the system gets overloaded and this offline thing just sort of can't keep up with the log messages. You'll pay a little penalty to update the metadata as you execute transactions. But I think it's one less moving part you need to have, or one less extra sort of background thread you need to maintain things. I actually think also now, I will admit, that the way we do this in the HTOR anti-caching approach is not actually the right way to do this. I'll talk a little bit about the end what I think is a better way. The problem with the metadata, the linked list approach in HTOR is that it becomes expensive to maintain, and we end up having to do sampling so that we're not updating this chain for every single transaction. So it's not 100% accurate anyway, and you're paying the sort of extra, I think it's, 8 bytes in the header per tuple to just maintain these pointers between them. And so if you don't have a really big tuple, like it's not really wide with a lot of attributes, you're paying a big penalty to maintain this metadata. But I still think it's better than the offline approach. All right, so now now we need a way in our database system to identify, all right, we're running out of space, now is the right time to start evicting data out and putting out on disk. And there's two ways to do this. One, you can just have sort of a administrator-defined threshold where you say my memory, the size of my database can't go larger than 80% of the memory that my database system has allocated. And then when the database system reaches above that threshold, then that triggers the process to start grabbing tuples and moving them out to disk. So in this case here, with this approach, it's up to the database system to decide how to move the data out, right? Meaning it has to spawn a thread that goes down to the database system or the database in memory and starts extracting out tuples and then writing them out to blocks on disk. The alternative is to use virtual memory, essentially mmap, where you don't have to set a threshold because the operating system knows how much memory it physically has. And the operating system can decide what pages or blocks in memory that you've allocated will get written out the disk. Right, so there's nothing actually the database system actually needs to do, which is nice to use mmap. But as I said, you have these other problems where you can't guarantee always the correctness of your database when you have transactions updating things. But it's kind of nice because you're essentially, in this case here, it is better in terms of I think it's going to be better performance and have better control of everything. But this one you get sort of essentially for free if you just use Mmap. And again, we'll see one example in VoltDB in a research system where they do this approach. All right, so now the first step was deciding how do we keep track of what tuples are cold? And then we've decided how are we going to actually move data out. Now the question is, what do we need to maintain in memory to keep track of the data that we've shoved out? And the reason why you have to do this, because you don't want to have any false negatives. You don't want to do an index lookup and have it not see the key that you know should be there because you shoved it out the disk and it's not in memory order, so you don't find it. So there's essentially three ways to do this. I'll sort of skip ahead and say that the last one, again, is using Mmap, or OS's virtual memory. And for this, the OS is essentially keeping inside of the kernel, it's keeping track of what pages it's been written out the disk, so that it knows that when you go try to read an address in your memory map file, it knows that it's in page 123, and 123 is not in memory, so you get a page fault, and then it goes fetches the thing that you're looking for. If you want to maintain this metadata yourself inside the database system, there's essentially two ways. The first is to use what we use in the anti-caching approach, which I'll call tombstone markers or tombstone tuples. And this is basically a marker or a special tuple in the table space for the table that you've evicted data from that has a little flag in the header that says, this is not a real tuple, there's no real data, it's actually a pointer to where the real tuple exists out on your on disk at what block ID and what offset. So you could follow the index, you would land on this tombstone, you have to check the header to see whether it's a tombstone or not. If it is, then you know that the data that's actually stored in the tuple is where to go find that thing. And I'll show what that looks like in a second. And so what's really nice about this approach is that you still maintain the in-memory index and have it just have 64-bit pointers to tuples. Just some of the index entries will point to real data, some of them will point to tombstones. And so when you land on a tuple, you just have to check, see what kind of data you're looking at. Another approach is to use a approximate data structure, like a Bloom filter, that sits above the table. And when you do a lookup on an index, you have to look at both the real index and the Bloom filter to see whether the tuple you're looking for is there or not. Right? So there's no longer any tombstone. There's no extra metadata you keep actually in the table heap. You just have to have two separate index data structures. And they use a Bloom filter because it's an approximate one, so it'll be less size than a regular B+ tree. You may get false positives, meaning it may tell you a tuple actually exists on disk when it doesn't actually at all, but you'll never get false negatives, meaning it won't tell you that a tuple doesn't exist when it actually does. And so in that case, if the Bloom filter gives you a false positive response, you're wasting I.O. to go look up data that's not actually there, but that's actually a pretty good trade-off in terms of reducing the amount of I.O. you have to do to go fetch other things. So again, these two are built in, you have to write this or implement this inside your database system. This is something where the OS would give you this for free. So let's look at the two examples that were inside the database system and see how those work. So again, our index is always in memory, and then we have an in-memory table heap, and then we're going to shove some data out the disk. And so the first thing we need to have is some way to keep track of what tuples are accessed the most. And therefore, we can identify the cold ones and shove them off. All right. In this case here, we can have a histogram. We'll see later on. You could also use like a count min sketch or other approximate data structures to essentially do the same thing. All right. So say now we identify the tuple 1, 3, and 4 are the coldest ones. So we're going to write them out the disk. And so if we're using, the indexes would normally point to where the tuples exist. But now we want to have them point to something else because we don't want them to point to this and then have this, be a tuple that it would not expect in the index because we want to end up reusing these slots for other tuples later on. So if you're using the tombstone approach, like in anti-caching, then you have sort of a separate space in memory for these tombstone pointers or tombstone tuples because these will be like a 32-bit block ID and I think a 16-bit offset. So these, are, in theory, should be much smaller than your regular table tuples. So you want to have a sort of separate space in memory for these, and that way you can reuse them as the slots as you move things in and out. And so again, these will tell you for, when you land on a tuple, it'll tell you what block to go find the tuple you look for and what offset to jump in, jump into. And again, this is sort of what I was saying before, is like this only works if the tombstones are smaller than your regular tuples, right? If your regular tuple only has a one, you know, one byte field, and you shove it out the disk and your tombstone is going to be, you know, 16 bytes, then you're just wasting memory. All right, so this only works if these guys are wider than this. The alternative approach, again, is to use the Bloom filter. And again, you would do a lookup, say, I want to find tuple 1 in for my table. I would do my lookup of my index. And if it's there, if it has something there, then I can go fetch the thing I want right away. If it's not there, then I go consult this thing. And then if this thing tells me I think there's something there, I can have a sort of on-disk index that goes tells me where to actually go find the thing I'm looking for. Right? Because again, the Bloom filter will only tell you whether something exists or not. It doesn't tell you where to go find it. So you have to maintain a separate index to say where to go find the data that you're looking for. Right? And again, if you get a false positive, then you do a lookup in the index and would find nothing and you stop there. So depending on what kind of index you're using, it will tell you whether you always need to consult this thing or not. So for example, if it's a unique key or a primary key index, then if I do my lookup in the regular index and I find the thing I'm looking for, I know I never need to go look here because it's here and you know it's only one entry. If I do a lookup on the primary key and it's not here, I always have to check this. If it's a secondary key or non-unique, then I always have to check both because I may get one, you know, for a particular key, I may get an entry that's in memory, and I may also get an entry that's on disk. So for primary key, it's either one or the other. Or sometimes both, if there's no match in the first one. For secondary index, it's always both of them. So what's another problem with this architecture here? If you use the Bloom filter. Yes?
Your index is in this disk, so you like when you're doing a lookup on the index, you might have to scan through multiple times
she said that because the index is on disk, if you do a lookup multiple times, you're always sort of hitting this thing on disk. This thing probably will be, at least, you know, a lot of it will be paged in memory. So you could cache it, it won't be that bad. But looking at something more obvious. So what access method did I show in all these examples? How did I get to the tuples? I went through the index, right? What if I do a sequential scan just right on the table heap? Would this approach work? No, because there's nothing in here that says, here's the tuples that I'm looking for, right? So this wouldn't work for OLAP queries, and this is sort of why we're focusing on OLTP. In the case of anti-caching, the way we did this is that you actually essentially had to basically do two sequential scans. You do a sequential scan on this on the first regular table heap. Then you do another sequential scan on the tombstone part of it. Now, because all of the indexes are going to be in memory, it may be the case that for a lot of OLTP applications, they make a lot of indexes. It may be the case that we can actually generate the entire tuple again just based on the index keys, right? Or if you have a covering index, if you have a query that can handle a covering index, even though the tuple you may need is actually out on disk, you may get enough information from the actual index itself, right? So for sequential scans, this is what I was saying, for OLAP, this won't work because sequential scans will have to scan everything, right? Because if you sequential scan on this thing, there's no metadata that says, there's nothing data that says what's actually there, so you'd always have to go fetch it. In the case of the Hecaton approach with the Bloom filter, you always have to scan the entire blocks anyway. I think at Hecaton, they won't even let you do a sequential scan if you push things out the disk. In our case, we'd support it, but we'd have to go fetch things. Okay. All right, so now let's say that regardless of what mechanism we use, we, in terms of identifying what data is cold and what metadata we're going to maintain in memory to say, you know, what's actually on disk. Now when we have a transaction that comes along and touches data, we know that something's on disk that we need. We go get the evicted tuple page we want. We're going to fetch that in memory. Now the question is, what are we actually going to merge back in memory? Right? At the very least, in the case of the first choice, you know you need the tuple that you actually were going to go fetch. So you have to merge that in, no matter what. Right? But then, let's say that what should you do with the other tuples that weren't required for your query, but they got pulled back into memory because we can only fetch things in 4 kilobyte blocks. What should we do with them? So the first approach is essentially saying, only merge back just the tuples that I need for that one query, or the set of queries that requested that block. And then we'll throw away all of the other tuples. And the idea here is that we now need to maintain some extra bookkeeping metadata to keep track of that the tuple that we excised out of the block shouldn't, if you need to go find it, you shouldn't go find it in that evicted tuple block. You should find it somewhere else. Because think about after a crash, we load in the checkpoint back into memory. We don't have to load in the evicted tuples because they were already out safe on disk anyway. And now we need to be able to know that, all right, if I need tuple 01, and before I pulled it out of my evicted tuple block, and I marked a hole in that block so that if you need tuple 1, it's not on disk in that evicted page anymore, I'll make sure I find the correct version I'm looking for. Right? So now we sort of break this notion we had before where before we said that in an in-memory database, there was only sort of one copy of the tuple at a time. And now we're sort of having multiple copies. We need to make sure we know which one's the correct one. So if we only want to grab the tuple that we need, we have to do some extra stuff. The easier approach, though, is just to take all the tuples, merge them all back in memory. And the idea here is that because we're going to be maintaining some metadata about, over time, about what the access patterns of queries on tuples, these tuples that got sort of incidentally merged back in when we fetched the block, they won't be accessed again in the future, so they'll be marked cold again the next time we have to do an eviction, so then they'll get shoved out the disk all over again. The problem with this is that we're essentially now we're thrashing because we're fetching in, you know, 4 kilobyte block, just go grab one tuple, then we're going to write out those tuples back again to make more space. So we're just bringing them in back and forth over and over again. And merging the data, all the tuples in a block, back into memory is actually not for free, because now we have to go update all our indexes to now point to those tuples. Regardless of whether you're using the Bloom filter or using the tombstones, right? We always have to update the in-memory indexes to now point to the new tuples we've added back into our in-memory database heap, or in-memory table heap, right? So if our tuples are really small, and we can fit maybe like 100 of them in a block, we have to update the index 100 times to go merge all these guys back in. And again, as I said, there'll be a lot of indexes in our tables in a sort of modern OLTP application. So multiply 100 times the number of indexes we have on that table, we have to update all of them. So that's not cheap. You need to do this within the context of the concurrency control scheme of the system. So that means that, because you don't want to have phantoms and other weird problems. In the case of HStore, it's the single-threaded execution engine. So we had to sort of block all our transactions to merge all these tuples back into the table heap. In other systems, if you have multi-threaded concurrency control, then you need to make sure that, you know, that adding these tuples in doesn't foul up other transactions that are running at the same time. So this is easier to implement. In terms of what metadata you need to maintain, but you're going to have more CPU overhead, and then the tuples are basically going to get written out over and over again. For this one, it's faster, but you have to do this extra stuff to make sure that you don't get incorrect versions of a tuple if you have to restart. All right, so now we got to deal with when a transaction accesses one of these tuples out on disk, what should happen to it? As I said, the two approaches we can have are we can just abort the transaction, roll back all its changes, put it into a side queue and have a separate thread go and fetch the data that it needs. And once we know that block is now in memory, then we can restart this transaction and it can run just as it was before, right? And now we won't have these won't have to get aborted because all the data that it'll need is in memory. So the problem with this is that there may be the case that the transaction actually has to touch needs data that's on multiple evicted blocks on disk. So you get to the first one, you find that the data you do not need is there, so you have to abort, restart, and then you go fetch the first block, then you restart it, and then now it goes touches the next thing, and that's not on disk, you have to restart it again. So you could have multiple restarts for your transaction when it's sort of blocking every single time it tries to touch data that's not on disk. Now the way we got around this in HStore with the anti-caching is that when you try to touch data that was not in memory, we just pretended that it was actually there and we let you keep on running, let the transaction keep on running. And only when you actually try to maybe modify the tuple or use the tuple as input for another query or return the result back to the application, then we would abort you and restart you. And the idea here is that we're going to let you run as far as you can go with the data that we actually have in memory and try to figure out everything you're going to need on disk ahead of time, then stop you, restart you, go fetch the data you need all at once, and then bring you back in. And this doesn't always work, because if you have, say, the output of one query is then used as like an if branch for the next query, if this, then do that, if otherwise, do this other query, this we have to block you right then and there. So you can't always do this. The other issue is that we can't guarantee that if the total working set size of the query exceeds the amount of DRAM that you have, we can't guarantee that you have a consistent view of the database. So what I mean by that, say you have only a gigaspace in DRAM, but you need to access 2 gigabytes of data from your table. So you in the first time you ran the query, you would get to the first 1 gigabyte of data, and then you would say, I don't have any more space, so then I'll abort and restart. Now you go fetch in the other gig, but that swaps out the first gig. So when you restart, you'll try to access the second one, but then you try to access the first one, and you get abort and restart. It's sort of, you keep restarting over and over again. You can't guarantee that everything's always going to fit. So this is, again, another example why we can't say this, why this technique wouldn't work for OLAP queries, because in those cases, the database, or the data you need for your query is certainly going to be much bigger than DRAM. And so under this model, this wouldn't work. The way to get around this would be, say I need to compute like a count on a table. I would run it the first time, it would count all the tuples that I have in memory, and then I abort the transaction, but know where I left off in my count, fetch all the data, the rest of the data that I need to come back in. Now during that time, other transactions could be updating things because I'm being put on the side. And then when my query or transaction restarts, it computes the count for the rest of the data that it just got fetched in. And again, that might have been modified by other transactions. But for OLAP queries, that might be good enough. That might be okay. So that's the big issue for this. And again, another reason why we can't always do OLAP with all this. The other approach is to do what a disk-based system will do is that as soon as you try to access something that's not in memory, it's been evicted, you just pause that transaction right there and then go fetch the data that you need, bring it back in memory, merge it into our indexes, and then restart the query right where it left off. Again, depending on what concurrent scroll scheme you use, this may or may not be a good idea. And actually, it also depends on what storage device you're using. Because if you have a fast storage device, this may not be a big deal. But if you have to go fetch something from Amazon S3, then that's going to be tens of milliseconds, and that could be a bad idea. Yes?
Can I go back to the previous slide?
Yes.
So for the first approach, you just grab a block in the memory and then just merge the tuples you want and then just discard the rest of it? Discard the block, right?
Yes.
Why not just, because in that case you have some holes in the block because you have to do some compaction to like save space, right?
Yes.
There on the disk. Why not just grab some like CODIS data to fill the, CODIS tuples to fill in the hole and then just write the new block back to disk. So in that way you don't have to do compaction later.
So his statement is, I'll say what we're doing here, and then I'll say what he proposes. And your thing actually might make sense. So What we do here is that we fetch the block in memory, just grab the one tuple we need, and then just discard the rest. We don't write anything back. What he's proposing to do is I fetch the block in, I pull out this the one tuple that I need, but then in its place, I'll insert another tuple that I was going to evict at some later point to fill in that hole, and then write that out. Right, that would work, yes. In this case here, you know, if you're doing this as you block the transaction, now you're paying for the read and you're also paying for the write. Now you could put it on a side buffer and then flush it out asynchronously later. But yeah, we didn't consider that. But that actually might work too. Another thing actually that I didn't really talk about here, but the thing you could do too also is you could try to pack in your block all the tuples, the tuples that are related to each other based on the foreign keys. So for example, like you put, like, say I have the customer table, I have the orders and the order items. I'll make sure that when I move out, you know, Andy's customer account, I also move out all his orders and order items. So when you go fetch a block, you're not fetching sort of random tuples from different, you know, from the same table. You're fetching all the data that's related together and more likely to use together. So in that case, you would sort of can use this, but you're not merging in stuff you're not actually going to need. That'd be another way to sort of solve this problem as well. But yeah, the filling in that hole would be a good one too. Okay. Right. So then the last thing we have to deal with is what tuples we want to merge back into memory. And when I say merge, I mean like, should I merge it back into the entire database and have it be visible by any transaction? Or should I only put it on a sort of a side buffer for my one query transaction that needed that data, and then when it's done with it, I can just throw it away? And again, the idea here is that we want to avoid having to go update all our indexes every single time we merge a tuple back in. So this is sort of, again, orthogonal to this point here, right? Whether what data we want to bring in to back into memory. This is now, after we decide what tuples we want to bring back into memory, which ones we actually want to merge into the table and update our indexes. So again, the easiest thing to do is just always merge everything. An alternative would be to only merge the tuples that were that actually be modified by a query and go update those indexes. Otherwise, just if the tuple is just being read, then we just have it the transaction read the data that it needs, and then the buffer just gets thrown away when the transaction commits. Now, of course, now the next transaction comes along and decides I want to read that tuple again. It's not going to be able to see this buffer. We have to go back and fetch the data again. And the last approach is that we can be a little bit smarter about this, and we can maintain some extra metadata again about how often each block is being retrieved. And when we find ourselves going fetching the same block over and over again, we'll go ahead and just merge everything in, right? To avoid this sort of back and forth of going out to disk get the same thing. All right, so now I'm going to walk through a bunch of different implementations, and I'll describe using the taxonomy that we've talked about here, I'll say what these different systems actually do. So we'll start off with the HR, the paper that you guys read. We'll talk about Hackathon, and then a variant of OltDB developed by EPFL. And then these are actually two systems that are actually commercial or people that are using in the real world, Apache Geode and MemSQL. So in the anti-caching paper you guys read, so in this version of the system, we were doing online identification. So again, we maintain a linked list or LRU chain about how tuples were being accessed. We used administrator-defined threshold to say when you got some capacity of your database relative to the amount of DRAM that you have, or your resident set size of the process got above some threshold, then you decided what data you wanted to evict. We maintained tombstone tuples when we moved data out. When a transaction accessed data that was on disk, we'd abort it and reabort it, go fetch the data it needs in a separate background thread, and then restart it at a later point. And then we were doing block-level granularity of the data we were bringing in. And then at this point in this version here, we would always merge everything. we'll see in later on, we had a later version of the anti-hashing stuff developed in HTOR where we could tune all these different things and see which ones actually worked. But in the version you guys read from 2013, we were sort of naively merging everything. So for the Microsoft Hackathon, they had this sort of side project called Project Siberia. As far as I know, this was never actually implemented or it was never actually released in like the commercial version of Hackathon. This is sort of like a research project they developed, but they never actually put it in because it had sort of the problems that I talked about before where you can't do sequential scans. So they were doing offline identification, so they would have a separate thread, read the log, and identify what tuples are called based on that. Just like in HTOR, they had a separate administrator and find threshold to decide when it was time to start evicting things. They didn't use tombstones, they instead used the bloom filters to keep track of what data was done on disk. They would block threads in a synchronous manner when they go to retrieve data. And they were moving things in and out with tuple level granularity, and they would just always merge everything. And like I said, they have a couple papers on this project, but it never actually made it into the real system. In 2013, the researchers at EPFL took VoltDB, which is the commercial variant of our HTOR system, and they modified it to actually do something kind of cool. So they were doing offline identification, just like in Hackathon, but they were actually now going to use MMAP. And so I'll show in the next slide how this basically worked. But the high-level idea was they would use malloc for hot data and mmap for cold data. And so what would happen is when you had this sort of background thread identified tuples were cold, you would move them out of the malloc allocated portion of the heap into this mmap side. And then eventually the OS would say, all right, I need to make space. My residence size, my process is too big. And the OS would be free to move all those things out the disk on the cold side. Actually, I take that back. The whole thing was mmap. They didn't use malloc for the hot stuff. They would use mAdvise to pin those pages in memory to prevent the OS from swapping them out. But the higher level portions, or the higher addresses in the memory space would not be pinned, and the OS was free to move them in and out as much as it wanted. And because, of course, you're using mmap, you have to use synchronous retrieval, because if you try to access this memory region that was swapped out to the disk, you would get a page fault, the kernel would suspend you, and then it would go fetch the thing you were looking for, and then when you actually got the data, when the data was pulled back to memory, then your thread was allowed to start running again. So this would be the same thing as synchronous retrieval. And they were doing this at a page level granularity because they were, that's what the OS wants to swap out an mmap. And of course, they would always have to merge everything because they had no control over this because the OS was doing this. So how this would work is you don't need tombstones. You still have your index point to just the memory region, but that memory region might be out on disk. So there's nothing special. Always merge was bad in the HTOR case and in the Hackathon case because you had to update all your indexes. In their case, they don't have to update indexes at all. So again, it would look like this. So say you have, say, the top portion of your in-memory heap would be for the hot tuples, and these would all be pinned in memory so the OS can't swap them. And then down here would be the space where you say, here's where I put my cold tuples. And then you would identify which tuples were cold, copy them down into here, in which case you would have to update the index to now point to this region. But then when the OS decided that it wanted to go ahead and copy it out, it just did that on its own, right? Does this in the background, it doesn't suspend your threads to do it. So then now when you want to go ahead and access it, you get a page fault, and then it goes and fetches it and brings it back in. So in addition to the synchronization problem that we talked about before, what's another problem you could have here if you let the OS decide what data to move out? It has to do with sort of alignment stuff that we talked about before. So one big problem would be you don't have complete control of where these page boundaries are, and you need to be careful about that you align things correctly, because what could happen is the OS could say, well, my page boundaries are here in memory. And so this one tuple may end up getting split into two pages. So those two pages would get swapped out, you would follow your index and it would point to this position here, but when you actually start trying to read the other data down here, you have to go fetch this other page. So before, when the data system had complete control of how it moved data out onto disk, we could be careful to make sure that for a single tuple it would fit an entire page. But in this case here, if we let the OS do everything, then it may split it up like this. So now what should have been one page fed, or one I/O to go fetch the tuple, is now two to stitch it back together. All right, so this is something we have to be careful about. All right, so then the next system is Apache Geode. I'm putting question marks here because I'm not 100% sure this is actually correct. And it's sort of confusing because Apache Geode came out of Pivotal. And it used to be called Gemfire, but there's also Gemfire XD, which is different. And Gemfire XD uses Apache Geode, but it's not the same thing as Gemfire. And before that, before Pivotal came out of VMware, and VMware had a system called SQLfire, which is related to Gemfire, but not Gemfire XD. So it's all sort of kind of confusing. And when you read the documentation, it's not 100%. They don't come out and say exactly what they're doing, but this best by knowledge, this is what they're doing. So they're doing the same online identification where you're maintaining some metadata about the access patterns to tuples. You again have an administrator defined threshold to say, when you reach some memory capacity, you start writing things out. I think they maintain tombstones to keep track of what's been merged out. And when you try to go access things, they block your thread and go fetch everything back in, but they're doing it at a tuple level. And what is interesting is that they only merge things back into the regular table space that when they're being updated. And so one thing I think that Geode can do is that what they're targeting for their cold data storage is actually HDFS. So you can have your database system write data out to blocks in HDFS, and then you can go fetch them back in when you actually need them. All right, so again, this is, the best of my knowledge, this is what they're doing. And then the last one we'll talk about is MemSQL. So MemSQL does something different than what everyone else does here. So in MemSQL, it's a hybrid system, so you have a row store and a column store. And so when you have a row store, that's always gonna be malloc. And so it never can be written out to disk. For the column store, what happens is they essentially just use memmap as the buffer manager, but they sort of have this staging area where they put all the deltas or the changes to the column store data in a sort of a transient row store. Right? Think of this sort of like a log structure merge tree. You have the mem table portion of it. And then when they start merging things from the delta store into the columns, they just use mmap and they let the OS decide when to write those things out. So because it's mmap, you don't need any extra metadata to keep track of what's been flushed out. You always have to byproduct of having page faults and blocking threads. You're doing synchronous retrieval. And they always just merge everything back in. The thing I'll say, when I say manual identification, what I mean by that is you as the administrator have to say that I want this table to be the column store, and therefore it uses mmap. So they talk about how you could have a row store, and then you could copy things out and put it as a column store over time if you want to get this functionality. I think this is okay, even though they're using mmap. And again, you get this eviction stuff for free without having to do it yourself. I think this is a good first implementation. I think that if you have more fine-grained control and let the database system do everything, I think you can get better performance. But for them, it's good enough. All right. So in the last few minutes, I want to go through the evaluation that discusses all these different design decisions and running them on different storage devices. So this is a paper we published last year in Daemon. Where we took the anti-caching stuff that we built in HStore and we extended it to support all the different techniques that we're talking about here. And then what was really cool about this is we ran this on a machine at Intel that had five different storage devices. So you had sort of the classic spinning disk hard drive and the NAND flash SSDs. We also had a newer drive, or newer type of drive from Seagate called shingled magnetic disks, or shingled magnetic recording drives. If you don't know what a shingled disk is, the basic idea is that it's like a spinning disk hard drive, but they pack in the tracks closer together. And what happens is when you write to a single position on a track, you end up overwriting the tracks that are adjacent to it. So they have sort of this error correction mechanism that allows you to fix those overwrites. And again, essentially you can pack more data into the same storage medium that you would normally get in a spinning disk hard drive. But what's really cool, and it will segue us into the lecture on Thursday, is that we had a hardware emulator that could emulate a 3D XPoint, which is the new non-volatile memory storage device that Intel just put out a few weeks ago. So this was a year ago. So this was an emulator. It wasn't actually the real thing. I think they sell it now under the name Optane. So if you've seen those news articles, this is what it is. And then then we had NVRAM, which is sort of think of this as, and we'll talk about this more of this on Thursday. Think of this as like DRAM in a DIMM slot form factor, but that's actually non-volatile. So in the case of the 3D XPoint, you're still doing the block writes that you would do in a regular SSD, but when it's an NVDIMM or NVRAM, you can do byte addressable loads and stores as if it was DRAM, but when you can do flushes to make sure it's actually being persistent. Again, I'll explain more about these different technologies next class, but this is sort of a good evaluation to see what these, all the different approaches we talked about today, how these match up with these new storage devices. So for the first sort of basic micro benchmark we want to do is we just want to see how fast these different storage devices can do writes with different block sizes. And again, think of this as being the eviction and retrieval speeds of what the systems can do. And so in this case here, obviously lower is better because we're measuring latency. And so the first thing you see is that for the spinning disk hard drive and the shingled disk drives, the smaller block sizes, 1 kilobyte blocks, are going to get you better performance because when you go to the 64 kilobyte reads, then you're going to have to read multiple blocks and fetch them in, right? In the case of the NVRAM and DRAM, you see that as you increase the block size, you get worse performance. And this is sort of expected, or much worse performance. This is expected because these are doing sort of single cache line reads. And that's the best case for these guys. So going beyond that, you don't get much better performance. Another thing to point out too is that in these expected NVRAM devices, the difference between the reads and writes are going to be asymmetric. So reads are going to be much faster than writes. Where in DRAM, it's a little bit slower, but not as slow. So you see a much greater difference in a read versus a write on NVRAM versus DRAM. All right, so now we want to see what should be the merging threshold for our system. And for this, again, along the x-axis, I'm showing the different storage devices. But in the case of the spinning disk hard drive and shingled magnetic disk, I'm going to compare also against the asynchronous retrieval, where again, you abort the transaction, restart it, and a separate background thread fetches the data. And then the synchronous retrieval, where you actually stop it and go fetch the data that you need. Now in this case here, this is YCSB, so we're only going to be reading 1 kilobyte tuples, one kilobyte tuple at a time per transaction. So what you see here is that in the case of the spinning disk hard drive and the shingled magnetic disk, the abort and restart actually ends up being the slower approach because we're measuring throughput here, so higher is better. And this is because the sort of the software overhead of aborting the transaction, rolling back to any changes that it made, putting in another queue, and then restarting the next transaction, that actually turns out to be the major bottleneck versus just blocking the data and getting the thing that you need. In this case here, the reason why this is higher when you merge everything is because if you merge everything that you read in the block, and then it's less likely that future transactions will actually need that data. Sorry, it's more likely that future transactions will need that data, and they won't have to block and restart because it had already been merged. In the case of the sort of solid state storage devices, you see they were always running with synchronous retrieval. And what you see here is that the gap between the merge all versus all these other ones is because the overhead of updating the indexes. If you have a lot of tuples, when you fetch the page, you have to update them to point change their pointers. So that's why this one is actually slower. All right, and again, you can compare this against DRAM. So this is what you would get when everything fits in memory. Right, as you can see, the NVRAM is not far off. And I'm not sure why this bar is actually slightly higher than that. That was a weird bug with the emulator. All right, so now we want to compare sort of a generic configuration, sort of the same standard configuration that we had in the original anti-caching paper that you guys read, versus a sort of a optimized configuration for every single storage device where we think we can get the best performance. And so what we'll do here is then we found that the synchronous retrieval and this merge threshold for everything is actually better. And then we'll vary the block sizes for the spinning disk drives versus the solid state drives. All right. So for this, we're gonna use actually two different benchmarks. The first one is this thing called TATP. Sometimes it shows up in the literature as TM1. So this is a benchmark that I think Ericsson developed that sort of mimics cell phone tower applications. So if you have a car driving down the highway, it has to update the tower to say, here's where to go find me if someone calls my number. So that's what this workload sort of represents. So for this one, what you see is that the generic configuration is always slower than the optimized one. So this is showing an example of that. If you tailor how we're gonna do eviction of and retrieval of data out on disk in our database system, if we tailor it for the actual storage device that we have, we're gonna get much better performance. In the case of the NVRAM, we're almost getting what DRAM can do. So that's pretty impressive. So for this application, it's actually a lot of updates and it's a lot of reads, right? And you're updating the cell phone tower, you're updating the caller list, and you're going fetching it. For another workload that is actually insert heavy, you see that the optimized one actually doesn't perform as well. So this is the Voter benchmark. So this is a benchmark that the VoltaBee guys developed that models the American Idol TV show. Like when people call on the phone and they vote for a contestant, they actually originally developed this for the Japanese version of American Idol, which then was later picked up by the Canadian version. I think it's just called Canadian Idol. So for this, it's an insert heavy because you have everyone calling all of a sudden in a burst. And for this, it turns out actually the generic configuration for these other devices, and especially the SMR, actually performs better because you're not paying the penalty of all this extra metadata to keep track of what data is cold. Right? You just write everything out as fast as possible. Right, and that turns out to be the best. In the case of NVRAM, it's so fast that you don't see a real difference. All right, so what are my parting thoughts about this? So today was really about how to add additional components inside of our database system, for in-memory database system, to be able to use block-oriented storage to extend sort of the amount of space we can maintain for our database, but without getting all the slowdown that we had from a slower disk. Right, so in this case, this graph here, it's about less than 10% slower than DRAM. In this case here, it's a lot more. So there's sort of not really easy way to get around this unless we have the NVRAM stuff that we'll talk about next class. So the other big thing about all of this is that I didn't show any technique to actually write the indexes out to disk. Right, we assumed everything, all those are going to fit in memory. Now you maybe say this is okay because if we had the right indexes, we can still do covering index queries, and therefore we never even have to look at the stuff that's out on disk. But I would say in practice, just as there's been cold data on disk that you don't really need in transactions, or sorry, cold data in your table, there's going to be cold data in your index, right? So if say you have a auto increment key and you're always just inserting to the right side of the index, the left side is not going to be accessed at all. So maybe you want to write those pages out. And none of these techniques that I showed here actually can solve that. And to the best of my knowledge, the only people that I think can actually handle this in an intelligent way is the Hyper guys from Germany. But unfortunately, they don't have a paper yet on what they actually do. I know what they do, and I think it's a good idea, but they haven't published it yet, so I can't talk about it. There's another paper that's on the optional reading list from HP Labs, actually also from Gertz Graffy, where they sort of do something similar, but they're sort of starting with a disk-based system and trying to make it in-memory oriented, whereas the hyper guys start with an in-memory system and they can add the disk to it in another direction, and they can handle indexes both and tuples. And so, but all of this, I would argue, everything we talk about in this class, as well as solving this problem here, will go away and is completely unnecessary if we have byte addressable non-volatile memory. And how far away we are from that depends on who you talk to. But on the next class, we're going to spend all our time seeing how you actually build a database system to use this. Because then you don't have to worry about disk at all, necessarily, right? Because what will happen is you just allocate a big bunch of address space. Some of it will be in NVM, some of it will be in DRAM, and you still use all the pointers you had before, and just whenever you go access stuff that's in NVM, it's just a little bit slower, right? Maybe like 2x to 4x slower. But in the grand scheme of things, that's not that much compared to going out to disk and fetching other things. So I would argue for, I think a lot of cases, maybe 10 years from now, everything we talked about here today may not be necessary at all with this. So we'll see that on Thursday. All right, so again, Thursday will be NVM, as I said, and then I'll also provide the sample final exam, and I'll be able to answer any questions. We'll go over it in the beginning and sort of give you a high-level idea of what the final exam will be about. I'll also say, too, on Tuesday next week, we'll have Marcel Konacker from Cloudera come and talk about the Impala system, so we'll have a guest lecture. And that's when I'll do a more comprehensive final review. Okay? Any questions? All right, I'll see you guys on Thursday.